Christa McAuliffe was to be the first civilian in space, but on January 28, 1986, Space Shuttle Challenger exploded, killing everyone aboard. In memory of the first teacher in space, here are some things about McAuliffe you may not know.
The winner, the teacher who will be going into space, Christa McAuliffe.
In general, when you look up information about the Challenger disaster, you'll find that Christa McAuliffe is referred to as, well, Christa McAuliffe. But as it turns out, Christa isn't technically McAuliffe's first name. To be clear, she did go by the name Christa, but when she was born, her parents faced a strange conundrum. As McAuliffe's mother, Grace George Corrigan, explains in a journal for Christa, they decided her middle name would be Christa, and her first name would be Sharon. They actually called her Sherry Christa, and eventually decided that Christa just fit her a lot better, treating it as her first name from then on. McAuliffe herself didn't even fully realize that her first name wasn't technically Christa until she looked at some of her legal documents, a realization that led to her signing official documents as S. Christa Corrigan, which was her maiden name. Aside from the Challenger disaster, Christa McAuliffe is largely remembered for being a teacher. After being brought onto the Teacher in Space project, she used her position to advocate passionately for her fellow teachers, but teaching wasn't always easy for her.
I always ask my students, you know, to go and seek whatever they feel they can do and reach a little higher.
In her book, McAuliffe's mother recalled her daughter expressing anger about how little teaching she was able to do sometimes, as students were excused from class for testing or for school fundraisers, which meant she couldn't actually put lessons together. In much the same vein, McAuliffe criticized the school's use of discipline. At one point, referring to unruly students, she said, "There are still a few I would like to string up." But the administration refused to offer any aid to teachers. She felt she was forced to enforce discipline after the administration suspended a student despite knowing nothing about the reason behind the suspension. In short, she felt like she was at school to do everything but teach. In hindsight, it's easy to say that McAuliffe was something of a hero, but at the time, McAuliffe herself would have tried to dispute that. In fact, at one point, she did. In mid-1985, McAuliffe was named one of CNN's Heroes of the Year. She claimed, however, that she hadn't really done anything yet or necessarily broken any barriers. Regardless, the title led to her being invited to present at the Emmy Awards for newscasters. She eventually gave in and accepted, but the overall experience proved to be unexpected. She and a friend were driven there in a limo, but after being directed to the floor of the hotel in which the show was being hosted, they weren't shown where to go. The pair ended up changing in a bathroom, after which they had to find somewhere to stow their luggage. The best place ended up being under the hors d'oeuvres table. And after the ceremony, the two friends got back in their limo and headed to McDonald's for soda and burgers with their driver. The decision to send a civilian into space was popular with the wider public, and the adventurous and personable McAuliffe was a hit with the media. But the same couldn't be said of her relationship with the rest of the Challenger crew. The crew was made up of scientists, engineers, pilots, and the like. Upon hearing about the Teacher in Space program, a lot of them were skeptical. And for a teacher to take one of the precious spots on the shuttle didn't exactly sit well. Judith Resnick, in particular, disliked the whole affair, accusing NASA of selling out just for the media attention. That said, the situation changed as the crew truly got to know McAuliffe. They couldn't deny that the attention was ultimately a good thing for the longevity of the space program, and it was clear that McAuliffe had worked hard for her spot and was continuing to work hard to meet their standards. They couldn't continue to dislike her after that. For McAuliffe, a perfectly normal person suddenly thrust into the spotlight, it would make sense that the fame would have been hard to deal with. But that wasn't the case with her, not even close. Plenty of reporters brought up the fact that she was no longer a normal civilian. She was something of a celebrity in her own right, and as such, could have access to money or political status, anything she wanted. But McAuliffe simply wanted to go back to teaching. In her own words, "I didn't choose my career so I could get monetary rewards. If the teacher in space doesn't return to the classroom, then something is wrong."
"I think any one of us would have done a really good job. I don't know what put me over the top, and I'm delighted to be here."
And it wasn't just in discussions about her future that McAuliffe demonstrated her humility. In fact, she often described her new life as being surprisingly similar to teaching or other aspects of her pre-space program life. When people came up to ask her for her autograph, she compared it to signing hall passes for her students, and it still surprised her that people would even want her signature. And when reporters asked her about her opinions on Challenger, it felt to her like a student coming up to her in a study hall for help with their homework. Astronaut training definitely doesn't look easy, and McAuliffe's experiences prove it. During her training, she spent a lot of time in planes accelerating at high speeds in order to experience forces up to 5 times the force of gravity. In her words, "You felt like you were melting into yourself, like the Wicked Witch of the West." Despite that, McAuliffe undoubtedly had a really good time. During zero-G training, basically riding in a hollowed-out plane as it rose and fell, replicating the feeling of weightlessness, she and her teacher backup Barbara Morgan were initially planning to take the whole thing very seriously. Aside from getting used to the sensation, they would test out some of the experiments McAuliffe planned to run in space. But the seriousness didn't last too long. As McAuliffe later said, it was hard to stay serious. Leapfrog? Why not? We figured kids would love to see that.
Space flight today really seems safe.
They posed in mid-air as if they were skydiving, and Morgan did actually hop over McAuliffe's shoulders.
The first leapfrog in zero goes to the belly. One leapfrog, two leapfrogs!
The Challenger disaster was a national tragedy, especially given that McAuliffe was a teacher, which meant that plenty of schools were showing the shuttle launch live to their students. Shortly after the disaster, a U.S. News & World Report story called it, quote, "the first ever national trauma on children." And while there were plenty of questionable things about Ronald Reagan's presidency, his choice to address this point explicitly in one of his speeches wasn't one of them. But the concerns didn't stop there.
I had hope for them, and I thought it was just the shuttle was in one piece in the water.
Full studies, including one published in the American Journal of Psychiatry, were done on children of varying age groups, examining their responses to the Challenger disaster over time and across various geographical locations. Without getting too lost in the details, the study found that children experienced the effects of trauma, even if they weren't directly involved with any of the astronauts on the Challenger crew.
She's just really special. It's hard.
Those effects persisted over the weeks following the disaster, generally fading over the course of the next year, though in a few cases, some of those children exhibited enough symptoms to be officially diagnosed with PTSD. It isn't surprising to say that Christa McAuliffe was well-liked by the students that she taught, but all the positive things that they had to say about her are worth remembering for the images that they painted of McAuliffe as a person.
The teacher observer, Christa McAuliffe, has been handed an apple by the closeout crew.
Speaking to Today, a handful of McAuliffe students recalled what it was like to see the launch. A group of them were gathered in the cafeteria with some of the other teachers, cheering loudly, even as the shuttle began to break apart, believing it was just the rocket separating.
I looked at the friend sitting next to me and I said, "Oh, I think that's supposed to happen."
It took them some time to fully process what was happening, trying to convince themselves that things were all right, then trying to keep believing that the astronauts might survive. As the truth dawned on them, the realization hit.
She didn't get to teach those lessons. She really wanted to teach us, and that's hard to swallow now.
They would never get to see her again, and they would only have the memories of how, as one student put it,
she made education real.
One of McAuliffe's goals for the mission was to help kids learn about space, but the other was to inspire kids to become teachers themselves, and on that front, she did succeed. Her former students interviewed by Today had all gone on to become teachers, and they still looked to her as their model on how to teach, bringing reality to lesson plans much like she did. McAuliffe's family had all flown out to Cape Canaveral to see the launch in person. Granted, her siblings couldn't actually stay for the launch due to it being delayed by a few days, but her husband, parents, kids, and even her son's classmates were all there to see her leave for space. But in a journal for Christa, McAuliffe's mother recalled the personal effects that she had taken with her on the shuttle. There were a few of her own things, a Bob Dylan tape and Girl Scout pin, for example, but also various mementos from individual members of her family. There were pieces of jewelry from her husband, grandmother, and sister, as well as her daughter's gold crucifix. And to top it all off, she also had a stuffed animal that belonged to her son, a frog that technically wasn't actually stuffed because it wouldn't fit in her belongings otherwise.
I think my philosophy of living is to get as much out of life as possible.
And her family also continued to feel her presence, even after they knew that she was gone. McAuliffe had bought teacher and space necklaces for her siblings, and after the accident, the family was taken to her dorm room, where they found her shoes and athletic gear still where she had left them just that morning. Challenger is remembered now for its tragedy, so it's understandable if you've never heard much about its actual intended mission. Had things gone smoothly, the crew would have deployed both the satellite and another piece of equipment meant to track Halley's Comet, and McAuliffe would have broadcast two 15-minute lessons, as well as a handful of other smaller experiments, showing just how different normal processes could be when carried out in space.
Good morning. This is Christa McAuliffe, live from the Challenger, and I'm going to be taking you through a field trip.
Of course, none of those things came to fruition, or at least they didn't come to fruition for a couple of decades. But in the early 2000s, more teachers, including McAuliffe's backup, Barbara Morgan, began entering NASA's space program and training to be fully fledged astronauts. Then, as 2017 rolled around, a very unique opportunity presented itself. Two educators, Joe Acaba and Ricky Arnold, would have back-to-back stints on the International Space Station. In other words, for nearly one whole academic year, there would be a teacher in space. Taking advantage of this year of education on the station, the two of them decided to also honor both Challenger and McAuliffe by revisiting her lost lessons, with some slight revisions to accommodate for the new location. Highlighting the daily life of astronauts on the space station instead of the space shuttle, they still managed to bring all of those lessons to life, demonstrating Newton's laws, liquid behavior, and plenty of other concepts in space. It took nearly 30 years, but McAuliffe's goal of engaging with students from space was finally realized.